Our last lesson on colligative properties is how to use colligative properties to determine the molar mass of an unknown substance. We know that if we know the identity, we can go a periodic table and we can determine the molar mass by adding up the atomic masses. But if we're given an unknown and we're trying to identify what that substance is, one of the pieces of the puzzle would be, what is its molar mass? And so this would help us determine the identity of that substance. So let's see what we've got here as far as a process, okay? We know the units of molar mass are grams per mole, right? And so if we can know the mass of the sample we put in there, that's no big deal. You weigh it out. You know how much mass of that unknown compound you put in, and you knew how many moles were in there, then you would be able to determine the molar mass of that substance, okay? So usually osmotic pressure and freezing point depression are used to determine these because these are very sensitive processes for determining changes, for determining the concentration of our particles. So if we go through and we use either osmotic pressure information or freezing point depression information, we can obtain out of those equations the molarity or the molality, in other words, the concentration of that particle. So you're going to take the experimental data and determine that concentration. In the case of freezing point depression, it's going to be molality. In the case of osmotic pressure, it's going to be capital M, molarity, okay? Now, molarity and molality have mole per something in there, right? It has embedded inside of it the moles that we need to get the molar mass. So from that concentration unit, we're going to be able to obtain the moles we need of that substance. We'll see how we'll do that. And then we'll be able to now know the grams, we'll know the moles, we can get the molar mass. So let's see how it's done with this example problem. I have 20 grams of an unknown substance. It is asking me to determine there down that last sentence, what is the molar mass of this unknown compound? So I know I want the molar mass, and I know the molar mass is the grams per mole. If I knew those two things, I would know molar mass. I read the problem, and you might want to stop and read the whole thing. I read the problem, I see that 20 grams of the unknown compound was given to me right off the bat. I read farther and say, well, were they nice enough to give me moles directly? And I read through and I see a bunch of freezing point depression information and I don't know the denominator. So I'm gonna take off and I'm gonna start seeing if I can determine the moles of this by using that freezing point depression information. The change in temperature of the freezing point, how much is depressed by, because it's freezing point depression, is equal to my equation, okay? I have been given this. Now, how have I been given this? It tells me that the solution has a freezing point of 3.77 degrees, but pure benzene is 5.5. So how is it being depressed? It's always the positive number, okay? This always goes in as a positive. So I'll take the big minus the small, okay? The K sub F is given to me for benzene is 5.12 degrees Celsius per molal. That lets me know that I can work in Celsius, okay? So I've got that. Does it say anything about it being an electrolyte? It's an unknown compound, it's dissolved in benzene. It does not, and probably if it were a problem on a test, it would say for the non-electrolyte. I know it's a non-electrolyte because I know that benzene, this is my knowledge, benzene is a nonpolar solvent, and you're not going to get an electrolyte to dissolve in it. So my I is going to be 1, and my molality is what I'm solving for, okay? Because molality will have moles inside of it. So when I take this difference, when I subtract those two, I have 1.73, okay, and I divide by the 5.12 degrees Celsius per molal, I'm going to get my M value equal to, what is it? It is 0.338. Now, this is molal, that's what comes out, but what is molal? Let's expand that out a little bit. Molal is 0.338 moles of my unknown I'll call it UKN for unknown, per kilogram of solvent. Now this is what I have. Now that's not moles, this is moles per kilogram. I need just moles to put in here. So what I can do is multiply by how many kilograms of benzene I have. It says I have 500 grams of benzene. That's 0.5 kilograms, right? I'm not going to do anything else, because if I take the kilograms of benzene and the kilograms of benzene, they're going to cancel, and what am I left with? So I'm just taking the concentration times the mass of that solvent, and I'm left with moles of just the unknown. And moles of just the unknown is 0.169. Now that's not the answer to the question. The question asks, what's the molar mass? Why did I want moles? So I could get the molar mass. So I will divide by 0.169 moles of this unknown. This was the mass of the unknown, this is the moles of the unknown, and that will give me 118 grams per mole. When you see this number, you should always stop and think, is that reasonable? Is that a reasonable molar mass? Yes. What would be unreasonable? Something less than one. One is the molar mass of hydrogen. If it's going to be a compound, it's got to be more than one. It's got to be more than two. It's going to be some number bigger than that. Helium is four. There's no compound that's between one and four. Okay? So that's a good number. 118, you can have multiple atoms hooked together and have that molar mass. So I like my value, and that is the answer to this problem. So that is how you would take information about a colligative property that's been measured, use that colligative property information to get the molar mass. What if it was osmotic pressure instead? In osmotic pressure, it has molarity that comes out. Molarity is moles per liter of solution. So if you multiplied by how many liters of solution you have, you would again get the moles of your unknown. So it's a very similar process if it was osmotic pressure instead of freezing point depression. All right, so that's the end of how to use colligative properties to determine the molar mass of an unknown.